We are discussing another data sufficiency problem now. This problem is based on the different floors and we have to allocate people to them. This question has a special method for solving it, and you will be able to use that method in a number of questions also. The question, although is actually the question of the type of seating arrangements, but it was asked under data sufficiency. So we will solve it as a data sufficiency question, where we will have to tell whether the answer to the question can be found on the basis of first statement alone, second alone, third alone, or maybe combinations of these statements. So let us start, read the statement and see how far we can take it up. He says, among six people P, Q, R, S, T and V, there are six people, each lives on a different floor of a six-story building. The building has six floors numbered from 1 to 6. So there is a building that has six floors, 1 to 6. The ground floor is number 1 and so on. Who lives on the topmost floor? We have to determine the person who is living on the topmost floor on the basis of these three statements. We'll see whether first one alone is sufficient, second alone is sufficient, third alone is sufficient, or some combinations they help us out. In these types of questions where you have to make a sort of allocation, especially the pattern, floor and people, it is better to draw a grid like the one I am drawing here. Keep floors here 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 and let us draw a grid, then we will put crosses on those boxes which will not be possible. So P, Q, R, S, T and V. This grid is completed like this. Okay. So this is the ground floor and sixth is the top floor. Whenever you have a question of the types of floors, I will suggest that you draw, you number them according to the way we would see in our buildings. Don't write one at the top, two at the top and like that. Write them in the correct order because it does help in solving these questions. At least it saves some time. At least on maybe relating them to the real world and all. Now he says there is only one floor between the floors on which R and Q live. There is one floor gap between R and Q. This piece of information will not be of any help to us at this stage. Later on this piece will come to our help. Scan further. P lives on an even numbered floor. From this grid we can now see that P cannot live here. P cannot live on odd 3. P cannot be on odd 1. From the first statement alone, all we have seen is where P cannot live and maybe something about R and Q. So we are dead sure that first statement alone is going to be no help to us. So we can write if we want alone not sufficient. Actually, as we will proceed, we will ultimately see that all three will be required. Okay. T doesn't live on an even numbered floor. I will put this information here because intuitively if we see this second one, T doesn't live on an even numbered floor, Q lives on an even numbered floor, Q doesn't live on the topmost floor, This second statement alone talks only about T and Q. So this is also not going to alone help us out. And we can see third one also. S lives on an odd numbered floor. There are two floors between S and P, T. And T lives on a floor immediately above R's floor. We can see that third also will alone not help us. At least intuitively we can see it out. So what we are left with is that we will have to make use of all the three statements. Now talk about the second. We will combine the information from the second statement into the same grid and from the third also into the same grid, because these three will together be used in this question. Okay, T doesn't live on an even numbered floor. T doesn't live on an even numbered floor. This means you will have to cross 6, 4 and 2. It's okay. Q lives on an even numbered floor. This means you will have to cross this, this and this. He also says Q doesn't live on the topmost floor. Q is not on the 6th, cross this also. This method I am teaching very slowly. You should try doing it on your notebooks also. This is very interesting method and also gives the results in a very consistent manner. Let us take the third statement also. S lives on an odd numbered floor. This means S can't be on 6, 4 and 2. Cross it out. There are two floors between the floors on which S and P live. This we'll use in the second pass. T lives on a floor immediately above R's floor. T is immediately above R's floor. This means if T cannot live on this floor, then R cannot live on this floor, because T will have to be above. But we know T can't be on the top. We have already drawn the diagram by checking out the various conditions. Similarly, if T can't be on 6th, then R will not be on 5th. That also you will have to cross out. And you can see for the remaining possibilities they exist. So this is the grid that we have after the first pass. From this, all we can see is that Q, R, S and T, they do not live on the topmost floor. Now the contention is between P and V. And in the question, the examiner hasn't talked anything about V. So this will remain the suspense till the end only. Let us now come for the second pass. We have left some statements. There is only one floor between the floors on which R and Q live. There is a gap of 1 between R and Q. R and Q. If R is here, then Q will be here. One gap. You can see. And if R is on this position, then Q will have to be on this position. You can see this also. And we can rule out this one because R cannot be on this position. Because if R is on this position, then Q will have to be either on this 5th floor or on the bottom floor. And on both we have already ruled it out. So we have just marked the dots to remind us that Q is here, then R is here, R is there, then Q is at this position. Okay, this is all we have for now. Let us move to the another statement that we left out. We left out there are, okay, one more thing you can see right now is that these two dots, they mean that at least one Q or R will be here. Because if Q is here, R will be here. If If R is here, Q is here, R will be there. This means fourth floor is occupied at least by Q and R. This is an important point here, which I just happened to see it here. Similarly, the second floor will be occupied either by Q or R. This means that P cannot be on the fourth, P cannot be on the second floor. And therefore, we can conclude safely that P is on the topmost floor. We do not have to proceed any further. Although, if you work out the remaining part, you will be able to conclusively determine who lives where. But right now, we can say that P is on the topmost floor. Nothing was said about V. V will occupy whichever floor is vacant for him after all allotments. So this is how you should check out the solution. This is how we can take up this question with the help of a grid.